Affairs, Dr. Dia Ayu Permatasuri. We have also here with us the Bureau Chief of Cooperation in International Office, Dr. Sohardi. And we have here the Dean of Computer Science Faculty, Dr. Chastuti Sri Lestari. And we have also here the Administration Head of Informatics at the Computer Science Faculty, Professor Ajiv Unizar Pratama Yusuf. And the Program Head of Informatics at the Computer Science Faculty, who will also take part in our program in a while. We have Professor Ahmad Fathuruzi. For the University of Mindanao, it is an honor to be joined by the Senior Vice President for Academic Planning and Services, Dr. Ronnie B. Amorado, and the Dean of College of Arts and Sciences Education, Dr. Christine Marie D. Concepcion. And of course, this could not be possible without the presence of our students, faculty, and guests who are also joining us virtually at this hour. For today, the University of Mindanao's Political Science Program is hosting the lecture series with the topic on Philippines-Indonesia Interstate Relations, a UM-UBJ webinar series. In this lecture, among the topics to be shared are the concepts of international relations and the significant impact on the bilateral agreements in the realm of politics. Now, to formally open our program, please help me welcome one of the professors of the Political Science Program at the University of Mindanao, Professor Lindsay Espino.
Good afternoon, distinguished participants, ladies and gentlemen, my friends in political science from the University of Mindanao, and of course, our new friends from Universitas Bayangkara. I am pleased to welcome you to the webinar on Philippines-Indonesia Interstate Relations for UM Political Science students and UBJ students and faculty to understand the deep diplomatic relationship of the two countries. We are also reaching out to many new friends from Universitas Bayangkara, Jakarta Raya, with this virtual activity. We all understand the importance of course, diplomacy to strengthen the relationship of the Philippines and Indonesia as partners in the ASEAN principle of promoting economic and cultural exchange, maintaining peace and stability in Southeast Asia, and establishing relationships with foreign powers with similar aims. Equally important is the diplomatic collaboration of these two countries in advancing their constructive interest in economic development and peaceful coexistence with other countries in Asia. With this, let us revisit the historical journey of the Philippines-Indonesia foreign relations and its significant contributions to ASEAN and Asia in general. By participating in this webinar, we are in the right place and at the right time. Together, let us accelerate the exchange of ideas and scaling up good practices in the field of diplomatic relations. I am confident that our great speaker today will present ideals of diplomatic relations of the Philippines and Indonesia that will sustain the efforts in support of greater ASEAN in the years to come. We wish you all a very successful webinar. To our new friends from Indonesia, terima kasih, and to all, thank you and good afternoon.
Thank you, Sir Espino. Now to introduce a speaker, he finished his Bachelor of Arts major in Political Science at the University of Mindanao. He then studied his Master's degree in Public Administration at the University of Southeastern Philippines. and gained his doctoral degree, Doctors in Public Administration at the University of Mindanao. He is also a member of the Philippine Political Science Association. And at the same time, he is a media practitioner, a managing editor and reporter at Sunstar Davao. Ladies and gentlemen, please help me welcome our resource speaker, the program coordinator of the BA Political Science Program, Dr. Alger P. Dura.
Thank you very much, Professor Bonnie Hamilton Rabaka. We would like to request the host to allow me to share my screen. All right, once again, good afternoon to all our friends from Indonesia and the friends from Philippines. This afternoon, I'm Alger Dura, your discussants this afternoon's webinar. My topic is all about Philippines-Indonesia's interstate relations, good neighbors in perpetuity. Okay. Our objectives this afternoon's webinar is, first, we have to be familiarized the agreements, negotiations, and forums entered into by two countries. And the other one is to keep abreast of the international relations between the Philippines and Indonesia. And this afternoon, I would like to bring your attention the historical background of the two countries, the similarities and differences of the two countries. Of course, Philippines and Indonesia are archipelagic states located in Southeast Asia. And of course, both countries are under a unitary presidential constitutional republic form of government. And both countries are members of the United Nations, the largest intergovernmental organization in the world. And the Philippines is an original member of the United Nations, while Indonesia was admitted to the United Nations on September 28, 1950. It sent its intention to withdraw its membership in January 1965, but announced to resume full cooperation with the United Nations and to resume participation in its activities in September 1966. Both countries are members of ASEAN integration. They are the original members out of the five original members. It is created for a common front against the spread of communism and promote political, economic, and social stability amid rising tensions in the Asia Pacific. Indonesia is considered one of the richest economies in the ASEAN, while Philippines is one of the developing countries in the ASEAN. The ASEAN headquarters is housed in Jakarta, Indonesia. Both countries are populated by Islam believers. Indonesia's majority population are Muslims, while Muslims in the Philippines belongs to the minority population. Both countries are also inhabited by numerous ethnic groups with distinct culture and languages. Then let's proceed to the history of relations of the two countries. Diplomatic relations between the Philippines and Indonesia were established on November 24, 1949, but even before the establishment of formal relations, ladies and gentlemen, my friends, friendly relations already existed between the Philippines and Indonesia. It is important to note that historical evidence provides that some of the ancient ancestors of modern-day Filipinos are Indonesian, Malaysian, Itas, and Polynesian. It is one reason of our relationship to Indonesia is very compact because of our blood ties. Bilateral relations of Indonesia and Philippines are reflected in the mutual visit of leaders and with high officials of the two countries. In addition, both countries are created or also created a joint commission for bilateral cooperation, JCBC, which was first held in Manila, Philippines in 1995. Indonesia-Philippines JBC is a meeting to strengthen bilateral relations between Indonesia and Philippines to discuss several areas of cooperation, ranging from economics, tourism, sociocultural, to security. And this cooperation has run quite well and has increased with the renewal of cooperation almost every 3 or 4 years. And until now, it has reached the 6th meeting. The Joint Commission for Bilateral Cooperation, JCBC, is a meeting at the Minister of Foreign Affairs level to strengthen bilateral relations between Indonesia and the Philippines. And the 6th meeting was held in Jakarta on February 24, 2014. The meeting, in addition to a progress made following the 5th JCBC in 2011, also produced 2014-2016 Indonesia-Philippines Plan of Action, which the bilateral cooperation between the two countries in various sectors that more targeted and structured. And friends, I would like to bring your attention to the ideals and aspirations of both countries as expressed in their participation in sub-regional, regional, and international organizations. So these are the ideals and aspirations of the two countries. Number one, similarity in the concept of regional solidarity and cooperation. Another one is the identification of common problems and mutual interest of two countries. Subscription to the same spirit of equality and partnership towards peace, progress, and prosperity in the region. And number four, fostering understanding and meaningful cooperation based on love for freedom, social justice, and individual concern for each other's economic well-being. And number five, preservation of national identity according to the ideals and aspirations of the family members. And this time, of course, we have to check the bilateral agreements, negotiations, and forums entered into by two countries. First, we have to present to you the bilateral agreements of the two countries. Number one, we have the 1956 agreement between the Republic of the Philippines and the Republic of Indonesia for nationals of both countries illegally entering and residing in territory of the other. The Republic of the Philippines and Republic of Indonesia, in furtherance of the friendly relations existing between them and desiring to conclude an agreement providing for the treatment which shall be accorded the nationals of its contracting party who are illegally entering in the territory of the other and establishing on a reciprocal. So this bilateral agreement is very important for all citizens of two countries. Of course, they are protected under this agreement. And more expeditious and simplified system of control for entry and exit of nationals of each of the contracting parties living within the specified border area of such contracting party and intending to make visits of limited duration to the corresponding border area of the other contracting party. So this is the content of the bilateral agreement entered into by the Philippine government and Indonesian government. We have the 1959 Cultural Agreement. So the first cultural pact of the Philippines with any ASEAN nation. So the purpose of two countries is to encourage more exchanges in the cultural field. And of course, we have the 1972 Air Transport Agreement. So the agreement is made to enhance flight linkages between two countries. Therefore, our airports in the Philippines has travels, flights from Philippines to Indonesia and Indonesia to Philippines as well. And we have the 1974 Trade Agreement. So the government of the Republic of the Philippines and the government of the Republic of Indonesia decide to promote and expand based on the principles of equality and mutual benefit. Another one is the 1974 Forest Agreement. So the government of the Republic of the Philippines and the government of the Republic of Indonesia desire to promote economic and technical cooperation in forestry on the basis of mutual benefit and subject to its country's laws, rules, and regulations. The government of the Republic of the Philippines and the government of the Republic of Indonesia, of course, agree to take appropriate measures to promote closer economic and technical cooperation between the two countries, namely the optimum utilization of forest resources, let there be the development of forest and forest-based industries, and the strengthening of position of both countries in marketing of products of forest and forest-based industries in world trade. And we have another agreement, the 1974 Agreement on Fisheries. The government of the Republic of the Philippines and the government of the Republic of Indonesia, considering the continuity of their territorial seas and importance of fish in the diet for both their peoples, noting that cooperation between the Philippines and Indonesia in the development of their fishing industries would be beneficial to both countries. Both governments shall promote mutual cooperation in the development of fishing industries of both countries pursuant to their respective investments and laws. Another one is the 1975 Border Patrol Agreement. So the agreement regulates border crossings. They agreed to increase border crossing stations, adopt measures aimed at improving safe passage of Indonesians and Filipinos between both countries and develop recommendations to enhance cross-border cooperation and maritime defense. The agreement is now subject to include the curbing of terrorism. We also have the 2001 agreement concerning the promotion and protection of investment. So again, the government of the Republic of the Philippines and the government of the Republic of Indonesia intend to create favorable conditions for investments by investors of each contracting country based on sovereign equality and mutual benefit. And such agreement will be conducive to the stimulation of investment activities in both countries, my friends. We also have 2001 Memorandum of Agreement on Tourism. Then the 2003 Memorandum of Understanding on Migrant Workers. And we have also 2004 agreement between the government of the Republic of Indonesia and government of the Republic of the Philippines concerning the delimitation of exclusive economic zone boundary. So as parties to the 1982 United Nations Convention on the Laws of the Sea, contracting parties intend to further their friendly relations by further establishing the boundary line that delimits the overlapping exclusive economic zone of both countries. Then we have continental shelf boundary negotiation. The government of the Republic of Indonesia and the government of the Republic of the Philippines took an important early step in the negotiation of the continental shelf boundary between the two countries through the convening of the preparatory meeting for the first special meeting of the joint permanent working group on maritime and ocean concerns through video conference on October 28, 2001. As two largest archipelagic countries in the world, the successful completion of the continental shelf negotiation between the two countries will contribute to the development of international law through the practice of archipelagic states exercised by Indonesia and the Philippines. So we have formal agreements, negotiation and forums entered into by two countries. So in the preparatory meeting, both delegations have exchanged views on the principles and guidelines that will serve as the basic guidance for the negotiation. And Indonesia and Philippines have also identified their respective base points. Indonesia and the Philippines agreed to establish a joint technical working group for the delimitation of a continental shelf that will operate under the mechanism of a special meeting for the joint permanent working group on maritime and ocean concerns. Then we have to check also the multilateral agreements entered into by two countries. We have Association of Southeast Asian Nations. In 1967, the two countries together with Thailand, Singapore, and Malaysia, of course, established ASEAN to ensure peace and stability in the region. And we have also Asia-Pacific Economic Cooperation. The idea of APEC was firstly publicly broached by former Prime Minister of Australia during a speech in Seoul, Korea on January 31, 1989. 10 months later, ladies and gentlemen, my friends, 12 Asia-Pacific economies met in Canberra, Australia to establish APEC. Then the following members were Australia, Brunei, Darussalam, Canada, Indonesia, Japan, Korea, Malaysia, New Zealand, the Philippines, Singapore, Thailand, and the United States. Other countries are also admitted to the forum. We also have Brunei, Darussalam, Indonesia, Malaysia, Philippines, East Asian Growth Area, BIMPEAGA. Its purpose is to shift economic activities from resource extraction to higher levels of processing and value-added production, focusing on industry and that adopt clean and green technologies. We also have non-aligned movement. Okay. Indonesia and Philippines are both members of NAM. It was formed during the Cold War as an organization of states that did not seek to formally align themselves with either the United States or the Soviet Union, but sought to remain independent or neutral. So Indonesia even chaired NAM during the Suharto administration. And of course, the United Nations. So the two countries are members of the United Nations. Then let's proceed to the trade between Indonesia and Philippines. Okay, this table shows the Indonesia's balance of trade with Philippines. So as you can see here, from 2012, 2013, 14, 2015, 2016, and 2017, there is a significant increase every year as far as balance trade of Indonesia and Philippines. So From the development of Indonesia and Philippines, export and imports that have been described previously, it shows that Indonesian exports to the Philippines are still strong enough to obtain a surplus each year compared to the Philippine exports. So Indonesia's main export commodities to the Philippines are the following. Number one, coal. Number two, copper concentrate. Number three, cars with cylinder capacity of 2,500 cc. Number four, motor vehicle parts and accessories. Coffee and tea instant, condensed petroleum, insecticides, tires. And Indonesia's main import commodities from Philippines, vehicle parts and accessories, insulation cables, medical devices, copra, lenses, glass, and other optical elements, electrical equipment, and electric capacitors. Then printing machines, vehicle gear boxes, sugar, milk, and cream powder, electric machine parts, and semi-equipment conductor. All right. I'd like to bring your attention to President Joko Widodo's visit to the Philippines. So Philippine President Rodrigo Duterte welcomes Indonesia's Widodo at Malacanang in April 2017. So they exchange a lot of programs, ideas on how to improve the economic growth of Philippines and Indonesia during that time. And of course, I would like to bring your attention how the Filipino people, how the Dabawenos welcome, respect, and love President Joko Widodo during his arrival in Davao City. Please watch this. All right. Once again, thank you very much for watching. And the video that I have shown to you this afternoon is an evidence that we really love and respect President Joko Widodo at all times. And I am praying and hoping that all participants in this webinar will always support our government's effort to strengthen our relationship between Philippines and Indonesia. And of course, this will help uplift the quality of life of the Filipino people and Indonesian people. Thank you very much and good afternoon.
This shows the camaraderie between the Philippines and the Republic of Indonesia in terms of political and economic affairs. Thank you, Dr. Dura, for the in-depth knowledge you have shared on interstate relations between the Philippines and Indonesia. So our guests, I know how excited you are to ask questions, but you can just simply type there your questions in the chat box. At this juncture, let us now hear from one of the faculty members and the reactor for this afternoon on the topic, the Philippines-Indonesia interstate relations. The reactor for this afternoon is a CESCO certified academy instructor. He is also a professional IT consultant and an infrastructure consultant. At present, he is the program head of informatics at the computer science faculty. We have here with us, Professor Ahmad Fathruzi. Good afternoon, sir.
Yeah, good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you, Mr. Rabaka, and also Mr. Alger Dura. First of all, we appreciate about the presentation. It is like Indonesian Philippines brothers. We know with history and nowadays. And I want to ask about point of view in military aspect. How Philippines and also Indonesia concerning about military aspect. We know about the country in the world, domination of United States of the military. How the military aspect become the basic concern about our environment political. In this area, we know about China domination. China also have domination in the Asia. How relationship about that? How your prediction about the future about that relationship? The first question is that. The secondly, we know about the industry and the industry 5.0. Nowadays, country is not physically aspect, but also technological aspect. What the borders about such as IT aspect on the relationship about Philippines and Indonesia. What we can build a trust, build a relationship with the IT support. Only that, Mr. Alger Dura, for my question. Thank you.
All I am pretty sure that the government of the Republic of the Philippines is very supportive to all projects, all programs of the government of the Republic of Indonesia. And in fact, during the visit of President Joko Widodo, they discuss about economic activities, economic relationship between the Philippines and Indonesia, actually. So they are very much supportive to each other as far as information technology is concerned.
Okay,
okay.
And what's a common interest in the technological aspect, such as we know this in this country, we know about such as game sport, e-game sport, like that. We know young people in here also interesting in that area. How you can show me point of view about the aspect of that?
Okay, about e-games, honestly speaking, Professor Ahmad, I don't have any further information so far, so please give me time to really research about the e-games as far as the Philippines and the Indonesia are concerned.
Okay, thank you. Okay, maybe the last question to you, Mr. Agar. We know in the future, it's also known about one nation, one world, one money, and one government. Yes, you agree with that situation?
All right. Honestly speaking, at this point, I cannot agree with that. I cannot agree with that because we have sovereign powers among of each state. So, and this time, I would like to hear from my colleagues, especially the political science program professors, because this webinar is not only for me, but we agreed among ourselves that we have to contribute something for this afternoon's webinar. So we have Professor Lindsay Espino and Professor Ranyun right here. Okay.
Okay. So let me answer the question of Dr. Ahmad Fatorosi about the single currency. So he is trying to inject about what transpired in the European Union, the journey of the European Union until such time it arrived on the perception that they must have a single currency. So right now our journey in ASEAN integration is still in the infancy stage. So we are not yet ripe enough to but maybe time will come if the economy of ASEAN will be better, will be strong, and it is an economic force in the global perspective. So maybe we can start, talking and conceptualizing how single currency will be implemented in ASEAN. But it will be a long journey. But we are hopeful. We are hopeful.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah, Mr. Lindsay, because of what in my country, nowadays, we also know digital money. So every aspect of our life is also bounded with digital money. Now, we can order food, we can move around the city with digital money. And also, is a concern of us if whether we can do it in the ASEAN scale, not only on my country also. That's our concern about that. Maybe next year or maybe next time, we can also concern about that because of what in the future, money is formed to digital money in the new platform. That's all. Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you. So we are looking forward because here in the Philippines, Filipinos are also starting embracing digital currencies in their online transactions. So hopefully Indonesia and Philippines will be journeying in that particular aspect.
Yeah, okay. Thank you.
Yes, and we are hoping that the Indonesian government and Philippines and other members of ASEAN countries would discuss and, of course, think what would be the best if you talk about one currency in the ASEAN countries.
Yeah.
All right. So thank you very much, Professor Ahmad. Thank you very
thank
much.
Thank you, Sir Dura, Sir Espino, and Sir Ahmad. Anyway, I will send the evaluation link for us to answer some few questions. Now, at this juncture, before the open forum, we will now be having the awarding of the certificates. Guests, I know that you're excited to ask questions. Again, I would like to reiterate, you can type your questions in the chat box. After the awarding of the certificates, that's the time for us now to raise the questions that we wanted now to know about the interstate relations between the Philippines and Indonesia. Okay. So we have now here the certificate of appreciation. The certificate of appreciation is awarded to Dr. Alger Dura for sharing his time and wisdom as the resource speaker during the University of Mindanao and Universitas Bayangkara Jakarta Raya International Collaborative Lecture Series entitled Philippines-Indonesia Interstate Relations, a UM-UBJ webinar series via Zoom webinar. Given this 14th of December, 2021, signed the President of the University of Mindanao, Dr. Guillermo P. Torres Jr., Director of the Universitas Bayangkara Jakarta Raya, Dr. Bangbang R. Suno. Let's give a virtual clap to Dr. Dura. And the Certificate of Appreciation is awarded to Professor Ahmad Paturuzi for sharing his time and wisdom as the resource speaker during the University of Mindanao and Universitas Bayangkara Jakarta Raya International Collaborative Lecture Series entitled Philippines-Indonesia Interstate Relations, a UM-UBJ Webinar Series via Zoom webinar. Given this 20th of December 2021, signed the President of the University of Mindanao, Dr. Guillermo P. Torres Jr., signed the Rector, Universitas Bayangkara Jakarta Raya, Dr. Bangbang R. Suno. Let's give a round of applause to Professor Ahmad Paturuzi. Virtual clap. At this point in time, we are now waiting for some questions to be answered by our resource speakers. You can also address your question to Professor Pattaruzzi and to Professor Dr. Aljardura. Anyone would like to raise a question? Again, you can just type it there in the chat box. I think there are no questions, and I believe that our guests are well informed by the bilateral agreements, especially in terms of political and economic affairs. While waiting for some other questions, I already sent the evaluation link in the chat box for you to answer some few questions. Okay, there is a question here. Good afternoon, professors. I am rather curious if the single monetary unit will be implemented, how it will possibly benefit the ASEAN, especially the Indonesia-Philippine relations. Dr. Dura?
Okay. Thank you very much, Claire, for your question. And this time, if we talk about the benefits of having a single monetary unit of the countries in Southeast Asian nation, for example, of course, it will be easy for us to really use our money in different countries. Like other countries in Europe, of course, they could easily use euros in their purchases and other purposes, of course. And as I said, this time we need more collaboration meetings among the members of ASEAN, of course, to really embrace this one or single monetary or currency in member states of ASEAN, of course. And this time, we are hoping that member states, for example, the Philippines, Indonesia, and other members would discuss further to really ensure that the single monetary will be implemented. And of course, it will give more benefits to the member nations of ASEAN. Okay. Thank you very much.
Are you satisfied with that, Mommy Claire? There are two questions here from YMCA Davao. How important is it to understand the dynamics of Indonesia and the Philippines, especially with the COVID in the context? COVID in context.
All right, we heard a lot of stories from news that the Indonesian government supports the fight of the Philippine government against COVID-19 pandemic. And in fact, they send donations to the Philippines and they send a lot of support to the Philippine government, especially in the fight against COVID-19 nowadays. And the two countries, of course, they discuss some important guidelines as to as far as health protocols is concerned, especially if you talk about travels from Indonesia to China to Philippines and travels from Philippines to China to Indonesia, actually. So I suppose Professor Ahmad or Dr. Ahmad has also some information to share as far as Indonesian government really help in the fight of COVID-19.
Thank you, Mr. Dura. In my country, the government have application that monitoring about the people and movement, people movement. We call the application is Peduli Lindungi. Peduli Lindungi is mean care yourself. It's mean if you have that application on Android or on iOS, you have to register on that. Then if you moving around in the city, you can tracking where you on the place is. So the spread of COVID-19, we have to monitoring of that people movement. So we can reduce about the spread of COVID-19. Also that in that application, we also monitoring how much participation in vaccine. In my country, vaccines is also done in maybe 70% nowadays. So also we can control them by the application. So maybe in Philippines, I don't know about that. The application is also, we have to apply the application if we want to public place, such as market, such as public place, others. Yeah. So the government stay focused on monitoring the people movement. Like that, Mr. Duran.
Okay, thank you very much, Dr. Ahmad. By the way, the Philippine government is also implementing QR codes, okay? So Davao City, for example, has a Davao City QR code. This will monitor the movement of the Davaoenos coming in and out of the city, okay? So once a patient is detected as a COVID positive, for example, so the city government will look into the other members of the family or other people who accompanied the victim, for example, just to bring them to facilities, and the government will give them aid, and the government will always take care of themselves, for example, medicines and other needed, you know, treatment in the temporary facilities of Davao City. Other areas in the country, of course, are doing the same. So the Philippine government is very much concerned about the welfare of the people. And a lot of programs, aside from vaccination, aside from QR codes, aside from strict implementation of social distancing, and a lot of programs are in place to really ensure that all Filipinos in the country are protected from COVID-19 virus.
Right, thank you, Dr. Dura. Thank you, Professor Patruzzi. We have also here another question from Sir Jasper Jade Baliscao. How is the principle of non-interference affects the multilateral relations among ASEAN countries?
So let me have my point on that, the right. non-interference. Actually, that is the problem in ASEAN. Okay, that principle of non-interference, but in the case of the South China Sea, which Dr. Farose earlier cited some points about the rise of China, and of course the peripheral states like Philippines and Indonesia and others are also affected by the muscular approach of China in the South China Sea, ASEAN, in the ASEAN context, okay? We should have a single voice. ASEAN should have a single voice, meaning the joint communique clamoring that ASEAN should be one voice in, of course, diplomatically, because militarily we might have a problem. Okay, diplomatic approach to solve. One voice, single communique, single voice of ASEAN condemning the massive claim of China in the entire South China Sea as far as exploration and even ownership is concerned. Okay.
Thank you.
So
Sir,
non-interference might be detrimental to the ASEAN interest as a whole. Okay, that's my point.
Okay, very well noted, Sir Espino. We have here another question from Sir Brent Leopoldo. Is there any chance that Indonesia and the Philippines would establish a robust military cooperation alliance to oppose the Chinese expansion in the Southeast Asia? So who would like to answer the question?
Okay, at this point, of course, we know that the present administration under the leadership of President Rudy Duterte, our government is very much concerned about the economic benefit, for example, and of course, the peaceful situation in the country. Therefore, at this point, we cannot establish a strong cooperation alliance of China, of Indonesia against China. Okay, so maybe in the near future, for example, we do not know who will become the next president. We hope that the next president will think of something to really improve our security in the Philippines by establishing military cooperation alliances with other countries. But this time, I would like to reiterate that the government is very much concerned about peaceful situation in the country. And the Philippine government, especially our president, is trying to really ensure that our economic activities, our economic aspirations will not be affected. Okay. That's why our president is keeping on making friends with China nowadays. Since we're friends with China, of course, you cannot make some activities that somehow will make some alliances with other countries like Indonesia to fight against in China, for example.
Let me add because Philippines and Indonesia has a different paths in its claim, in its struggle against China. For Indonesia's part, I think the government of Widodo is strongly exercising in protecting the territorial, the sovereign rights of Indonesia against the Chinese incursions in their exclusive economic zone. Okay, so there are instances that we can hear in the news that they wanted to have a confrontation. Okay, so which in our part in the Philippines, we have a path with less confrontation.
Exactly.
So economic aspect, but of course the main problem, if we have a special relationship with China, we should also have special relationships with other countries. We should not make enemies, and too much concentration to China might also endanger our territorial integrity. I think military exercises with Indonesia and others, of course, we have Singapore, of course, the United States of America, South Korea, and Japan. Those are military exercises, collaborations that has a point of unification. So Meaning, we as political science, we knew about gunboat diplomacy, something like that. Okay, that do not threaten us because that is part of the strategy in international relations that will de-escalate armed conflict.
Yes.
Okay. Thank you, Sir Lindsay Spino. We have a question here that is being addressed to Professor Ahmad. Yeah. The question, Professor, is what do you think is the position of Indonesian government with regard to climate change and sustainable use of environmental resources? Is there any agreement between the two countries?
Yeah, okay. Is there Indonesian government have what is that? Agreement in maybe Asian countries about the sustainable environment resources. We have to concern about that because of what? Because Indonesian forest and Indonesian use that forest to have to we call it the green society, and also people maybe small people about what we have to do in that environment. We also have to make environment cleanly. We also such as in the Jakarta, we have also sustainable climate concern. With we have rule about the mobility in the motorcycle. We have a plan program about people who have to around the city use the public transportation. That is our concern about the government. We limited the movement of people who have personal vehicle because personal vehicle has more pollution if we use by personal. If we use public transportation and integrate it with the public transportation, so we can decrease the population in our environment, such like this. And also Jakarta have honorable achievement of about that. Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Sir Ahmad, for the answer. We have another question here from... Oh, there's a follow-up question by Sir Brandon M. Pado. Sir Ahmad, he just wanted to clarify if it's there any agreement between the two countries concerning sustainable development.
Yeah, I don't know exactly about the agreement with these two countries. Yeah, I don't know exactly what the agreement is, but the Indonesian initiate the program such as like that to be what is copy in the our country in the ASEAN. So the ASEAN government can copy the program about the about the climate control, and we have control the pollution in the big city. Like that.
Okay, thank you, sir. Another question from the YMCA. Since YMCA is an international group empowering the youth, they just wanted to know about how do you see the role of the youth in the post-pandemic setup between the Philippines and Indonesia in terms of economics, peace, and environment? Who would like to answer the question? Sir Ahmad? Sir Alger?
All right. Okay. Thank you very much. We cannot deny the fact that our youth nowadays play a role in the promotion of economic peace and, of course, environment. And our youth nowadays are very much concerned about our environment because their aspiration is to really ensure that the Philippines and, of course, the world will be free from global warming, for example. And therefore, youth in the Philippines are very active in greening program of the Department of Environment and Natural Resources. And the Department of Environment and Natural Resources office is keep on asking support from the youth. And as far as I'm concerned, DENR and other agencies like City Environment and Natural Resources, they have advocacies naman involving youth, especially in the protection of environment. In Davao City, we have IDIS, Integrated Interfacing Development Systems. So this non-government organization keep on organizing youth organizations in Davao City to really promote their environmental advocacy spot. So we really believe that the youth is very much important in our cause to really ensure that the Philippines and other part of the world are safe from global warming, okay, caused by climate change.
Thank you, Sir Alger. We have another question here from one of the attendees. What is the position of the two countries, the Philippines and Indonesia, with regard to what is happening in Myanmar's coup? I believe Sir Ahmad is ready to answer the question.
Yeah. In our country, we political aspect is global freedom. It means that we support the people Myanmar's about that action. Myanmar's if Myanmar's what is that have election or others about concern about the maybe what is that mean like democracy or others, we depends on the Myanmar's people. We cannot interfere about the what happened in Myanmar. Like that, active global active mean like we not support the we can interfere about the Myanmar's political aspect like that.
Okay.
Maybe thank in you, the sir. Philippines, I don't know about the political aspect like that.
Okay, I'd like to add, in the Philippines, of course, President Rodrigo Duterte urged fellow ASEAN leaders to stand with Myanmar after military took control of the country in ECO earlier this year. And in fact, in his speech at the 39th ASEAN Summit plenary held in last October 26, our president expressed concern that Myanmar's crisis would worsen the impact of prevailing COVID-19 pandemic. And the president is very much concerned about the situation in Myanmar. And he requested some leaders of ASEAN to really stand, with Myanmar, okay, with Myanmar. And of course, other leaders during that plenary or summit plenary express their support call of President Rodrigo Duterte, because the president emphasized the need to stand with Myanmar in resolving issues peacefully and in a manner that prioritizes the welfare of its people. So the president is very much concerned about the welfare of the people in Myanmar, and of course, Filipino people working in that particular place. And he's asking actually to really resolve in a peaceful manner. So that's the stand of the president of the Republic of the Philippines. As far as crisis in Myanmar is concerned, Bob.
Thank you, Sir Alger. Do we have any other questions? So we have another question here, Sir Alger and Sir Ahmad. How could the Philippines and Indonesia cooperate for them to recover from the pandemic? How could they contribute to help each other to recover?
Okay. All right. Nowadays, the Philippine government is keep on trying its best to really improve the economic activity of the country after the pandemic. Of course, our approaches here, the social distancing, the quarantine of the overseas Filipino workers from other countries, including Indonesia, are in place. And of course, they keep on asking Philippine counterparts in Indonesia to really help the Philippine government how to address the adverse effect of COVID-19 pandemic nowadays. Then, as far as I'm concerned, because I interviewed some of the government officials here in Davao City, and they told me that at this point, the City Tourism and Operations Office of Davao City is having different consultations with other leaders, especially in Indonesia.
In addition, let me add, Indonesia and Philippines are both archipelagic countries. Okay, so one of the Asian countries visited by tourists is Indonesia, specifically Bali and other beautiful spots in Indonesia. Of course, the Philippines at the same time, we have our jewel in tourism. Tourism might help recover the economy of both Indonesia and the Philippines with proper collaboration. But of course, right now, let me tell you, both countries, Philippines and Indonesia, are recipient of foreign loans from World Bank and IMF. Probably World Bank and IMF can provide the loans and ignite economic development after what we call the post-pandemic approach. So that is my point.
Okay. And in fact, earlier, the City Tourism Office has promoted the cheap flights from Davao City to Indonesia. That's one of the strategies of the Tourism Office, national and local government unit of Davao City. And they promote cheap flight or fare among Davaoenos or other citizens, other residents of in Mindanao to really go to Indonesia and vice versa. People in Indonesia are invited to go to here in the Philippines, because if we talk about safety in Davao region and other parts of Mindanao, the records of the Department of Health as far as COVID-19 cases is concerned is still decreasing and decreasing. And the chief operation officer of the city tourism office is trying to really promote the the best practices of Davao City in other places, including Indonesia. In fact, Davao City the other day was awarded third as the most city that implemented risk bakuna in Davao City. We have Bakuna by the Sea. So the Bakuna by the Sea targeted 12,000 employees in tourism sector. Okay, tourism sector to be vaccinated. And in fact, the 12,000 tourism sector employees were vaccinated actually last November. And that's the reason why Davao City was awarded as third place in that particular competition. Yeah, different strategies implemented by the city government of Davao. And it's because of the campaign of the City Tourism Office and the Department of Tourism Region 11 to promote our tourism industry in Davao City. And in fact, they keep on inviting other government officials in other countries to really visit in Davao City. So again, it's correct that the tourism industry will help us boost our economy after the COVID-19 pandemic. And in fact, nowadays, Davao region is opening the different tourism sites, especially the Island Garden City of Samal. Island Garden City of Samal just recently opened the 24/7 transportation from Davao City to Island Garden City of Samal. It's one way of their promotion to really promote the tourism activity of Island Garden City of Samal. Okay, so with this, the Philippine government and Indonesia may cooperate more, may discuss some strategies on how to really improve the tourism activities, tourist spots of the Philippines, Mindanao specifically, and Indonesia. So with their cooperation, of course, we believe that Philippines and Indonesia are friends naman. And of course, our foreign officials and their counterparts in Indonesia are doing the same, are doing good to improve the economy of two countries after the pandemic.
Okay. Yeah, Mr. Bon.
Yes, sir. Go ahead.
Maybe we know about the pandemic also affect on the e-commerce. Also, Indonesia have to concern about e-commerce with platform application. In my country, platform application was increased very high, such as Tokopedia and Bukalapak, if you know. Such as Alibaba in the Asia or in the world. Even small host can make a transaction directly to others participant in the e-commerce. So we have to initiate and can we collaborate Indonesian relationship about Indonesia and Filipina, have to open the marketplace. We have to agree with them. Yeah, maybe people of Philippines can also sell about their products online, and also Indonesian people can also sell our product to them in the platform e-commerce. So if we have joined that e-commerce platform, we can have relationship, a better relationship, and also have income in maybe people to people. In the past, maybe only government to government, but in the next time, maybe we also people by people in other countries, not only boundary about the country. Okay? People on people. People in Indonesia can also transition with people on the Philippines. Because we have nowadays flight or about services to delivery the product by in Asia is cheap and more cheap than before. So we can initiate the platform of e-commerce that we have done in my country. Okay, thank you.
Thank you, sir. There's this question. This would be probably the last question. Sir Sumirado Rahman wanted to ask a question. It's just for him to know because it seems that he's curious about the educational system you have there, Sir Ahmad, in Indonesia. So his question here, sir, is in this time of worldwide pandemic, educational institutions has greatly affected by health crisis. From normal teaching methods shifted to online class, how is the education system in your country during this pandemic?
Okay. Thank you. Our country have delivered the program by the name MBKM. Yeah. Merdeka Belajar Kampus Merdeka, MBKM. It means that campus or university have open mind in the sector of professional sector, that the office or other industry can open their minds to have to transfer knowledge from one knowledge to another. So the campus or lecturer in the faculty can join that program. And also in the online systems, we can also open the program in online system by the professional private sector. Yeah, there's also the student in the university can apply the professional sector by elaborate with the university. Even the program is a new program that delivered by the government, but we can improve time by time. We can improve that join the program, and we can look at the program in the perspective way about the about the system. We also know if the student have study in the university, they have to know about the professional program, the professional in the work today. So our government have initiated the program that joining with the professional system in the private sector with the university. So like that.
Thank you, sir. Okay. So,
Sir Boni.
Yes, Sir Dura. Yes, po.
Professor Bon Rabaka, can I share our practices here in the Philippines for the benefit of our participants from Indonesia? Okay. In the Philippines, the Department of Education has developed modules for students from elementary to secondary students. Okay, so the government has allotted billions of pesos for the modules and other needed materials for the delivery of quality education to the Filipino people, to the Filipino students. Okay, and in tertiary level, of course, the Commission on Higher Education mandated all universities and the colleges to really embrace the new normal, and all schools shall adopt the online classes. And in the case of the University of Mindanao, we have the Blackboard learning management system. The university has allotted millions of pesos for this most expensive platform online, just to deliver the quality education of our students. Okay, and this platform has been used by the university for how many years, even before the pandemic. And we humbly inform you that the University of Mindanao was prepared even before the pandemic, during the time that all schools, all colleges and universities adopted the online classes. Thank you.
All right. This is how indispensable, again, international relation is, diplomatic practices. Well, of course, we know that every country is in dire need to achieve political stability and economic development. And with that, we have these two countries who have gained now their agreements to be achieved the soonest possible time. We know that the Republic of Indonesia and the Republic of the Philippines are having plenty of ties, plenty of agreements for the betterment and for the welfare of every citizen. Thank you, Dr. Dura. Thank you, Professor Paturuzi. At this juncture, let us all welcome the administration head of informatics at the computer science faculty, Professor Ajip Yunizar Pratama, for the closing remarks.
Thank you. Assalamualaikum. Magandang hapon po. The Honorable Dean of Faculty of Political Science, Professor Lindsay Espino, the main speaker in this seminar, Dr. Alger Dura, Mr. Chairman and of the Mr. Chairman of the committee, and all of audience who has come in this event. We have reached the end of the international collaboration discussion series that proposed topic about Philippines-Indonesia, interstate relations, good neighbors in perpetuity. In the history, diplomatic relations between the Philippines and Indonesia were established on November 24, 1949. But even before the establishment of formal relations, friendly relations already existed between the Philippines and Indonesia. Philippines and Indonesia have many similarities, such as located in Southeast Asia, form of government are unitary presidential constitutional republic, members of ASEAN and the United Nations. Both countries are also inhabited by numerous ethnic groups with distinct culture and languages. Both countries are populated by Islam believers, but the difference is Indonesia's majority population are Muslims, while the Muslims in the Philippines belong to the minority population. We are very proud to get many similarities and participation in sub-regional, regional and international organizations. We hope to be able to continue to develop cooperation with the Philippines and in many sectors and many years, especially in cooperation between universities. Since 2016, between Universitas Bhayangkara Jakarta Raya and University of Mindanao have many activities such as student exchange, lecturer exchange, and also international collaborative lecturer series like this event. Finally, thank you to all international collaboration discussion series and to everyone involved in planning and holding this event. We are truly grateful for your valuable contribution and attendance. Thank you again. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Sir Ajip. I would like to inform everyone that I have already sent the evaluation link in the chat box. Please do access it to answer a few questions. Before we leave, we are asking to please just turn on your respective cameras for our group photo. Okay. For a while, I'm just I will just set this screen that I have.
No, okay. Smile.
if you can just give us your best smile. Ready, 1, 2, 3, smile. All right. And that ends our collaborative lecture series for today. I hope that everyone is filled with lots of knowledge concerning the bilateral agreements between the Philippines and Indonesia, and an immense understanding of international relations. Once again, thank you very much to our speakers for today, Sir Aldre Dura and Sir Paturuzi. And we have also here Ma'am Isa Munte de Ramos and Sir Bench from the External Affairs of the University of Mindanao. This has been your host for today. My name is Bon Rubaca, one of the instructors of the Political Science Program at the University of Mindanao. Thank you and good afternoon.
Thank you very much.
ダンスパフォーマンスを披露しました。